Show me your world, Chris.
Well, I thought we'd start with Crouch Tram Museum.
Great.
Dear Mum, Yorkshire is lovely, not like you said at all. They can smile, and they do sell my pasta sauce. The caravan bed is quite short, but Chris is a sensitive lover. Hope you can be happy for me. Love, Tina.
Yeah, good girl.
You are going to pick that up.
I didn't do that.
If you don't pick up this excrement immediately, then I'm going to have to inform the National Trust.
Report that to the National Trust, mate.
I don't want this to ruin our holiday.
Get in.
Never thought about murdering innocent people before.
It's not a person, Tina. He's a Daily Mail reader. Say one word and it's...
I get it. It's just thinking outside the box.
The police are pursuing a ginger-faced man and an angry woman.
Sit!
You're a liability. You're just like your mother.
Has it gone wrong?
Yeah, a bit.
You didn't let him see you do number twos, did you, Tina?
We both said what a nice couple we thought you were.
Oh, I love her.
I can fly!
Everyone else seems to find it so easy to express themselves. I mean, even you've got your knitting. Have you had a nice holiday?
Yeah, I've had a brilliant holiday.
Fuck you!
Hello. Hello, and welcome to the Eurogamer Expo Developer Sessions. I think that's good. Thank you very much. Before we get started, just a little bit of housekeeping. As you may know, we're streaming the majority of these sessions, including this one, live on YouTube. We're also archiving them there. So we do ask that there is no filming on phones or digital cameras. If you want to see it again, it will be in high def on YouTube at youtube.com/Eurogamer. So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to Frank O'Connor, Franchise Development Director at 343 Industries, who's going to talk to you about Halo 4.
Hello. Can you guys hear me? I can't hear me, so if you can't hear me, speak up. So thank you, everyone, for coming this morning and standing in line. A lot of you were standing in a couple of lines, one to get in and then one to get into the session. And that means that you're not playing the game, which is downstairs. And we have a bunch of multiplayer for you guys to play downstairs, so I encourage you all after this, as long as I don't blow this demo and make it look bad, to go down and try it out and hopefully have some fun. We're really, really close to finishing the game now. There's just a few last-minute things that we're doing for the next few days. And, of course, we'll announce when it does go gold. But it's almost done. There's parking spaces available in the parking lot for the first time in 6 to 8 months. And during that time, our team has been crunching like mad to finish Halo 4. And that means that they have sacrificed a lot. You know, it's not just working long hours. There's a lot of things that you sacrifice when you're working on a game, and it's true of any big AAA game title. We were doing the credits for the game recently and discovered that we've got about 17 or 18 babies born to the studio since we got started. So it's a very romantic office, obviously, for one thing. But it's both awe-inspiring and sort of sad to know that people are sacrificing these moments of their lives and missing bits of their kids growing up because of the passion and the energy that they're pouring into this game. And we think it's all worth it. We've worked really hard to do something really cool with the game. But obviously, I want to thank our staff. I get to swan around the world representing the game without actually doing any hard work or coding or anything like that, while those guys are back there working really long hours to get it out the door. But I also wanted to thank Bungie Studios. They created a universe that I love and that I stayed with, and they created a bunch of technology that's the platform and the basis for what we've done. Now, we've taken it further, and we're really excited about the results, and that's what we want to show you today. I have a hopefully 10-minute demo for you today, unless I die, of a campaign level, and it's actually the third level in the game. And so if you're averse to spoilers, you have two choices. You can either flee and stay in the bathroom until it's over, or you can put a coat over your head, is about your only options at this point. It's the third level of the game, and we're showing that because it's a pivotal part of the game. It shows you the covenant that you're used to, battling the Prometheans that you're going to be used to, that you're going to learn to hate or love, depending how you look at it. And it shows you their conflict and a little bit of a turn in that conflict. We're going to try and keep spoilers out of it. So it's going to fade to black at a very pivotal moment, and you'll know exactly what that is. I'm just going to try and do my best not to die and pray that it doesn't crash, because it did a couple of days ago. We have an emergency contingency if that happens. But that's it. Without further ado, I'm going to start the demo, and pray for me. It's supposed to do that. That one I knew about.
Sounds like the Prometheans don't want the Covenant here either. The battle net's already lighting up with reports of resistance all around the pylon.
Thank you.
heading up a little. We're almost to the beach.
Beam.
planet's core. They know we're here. Infinity, this is UNSC AI Cortana. Do not approach Forerunner planet. Repeat, do not approach...
UNSC asset. Forerunner is on. We need you, but you're breaking up. Help. Increase speed by 0.7. Get us in there.
Negative, Infinity. Do not enter the planet.
If you can hear us, keep transmitting.
No, Chief, you've got to get that beam down now. There's bound to be a central control point.
The Covenant are moving towards the relay, too.
This doesn't make any sense. Why would they care about a broadcast relay?
I'll handle them. You just find us that control node.
Phew. well, that's a big relief. So, Halo 4 comes out November 6th worldwide, with the exception of Japan. They get it on November 8th because of the way that their games are released. But on October 5th, we are going to start a kind of unique digital TV series. It's going to air on Machinima Prime, which is the biggest YouTube channel. And it's a piece of fiction set 20 years before the events of Halo 4. And it's going to do a bunch of things. It's obviously great for hardcore fans who want to see Halo brought to life in live action, as we typically do with TV commercials. And we're also going to have a pretty exciting TV commercial soon. But it's designed to introduce you to the Halo universe in a pretty unique way. It's designed to introduce you via people and characters. And some of those characters are going to be featured in both Halo Campaign and in Spartan Ops, and are going to become important to the universe going forward. It is set 20 years before the events of our game, and the interesting thing about that is it gives us a chance to make it an origin story. And it's going to tell you the origin of the Human Covenant conflict. It's going to tell you the origin of some of the characters that I mentioned. And it's also going to feature the origin, somewhat, of the Master Chief, or at least some of his earliest action in the field. We're really excited about it, and it starts in about a week, October 5th, and it will air weekly up until the launch of the game. And I think we have a trailer to show you guys from Forward Unto Dawn.
The pincer movement. Red represents the Romans' troops, blue Hannibal's. When the Romans attacked, Hannibal's cavalry galloped in from behind. The Romans were completely surrounded.
How do we apply this?
Drop behind enemy lines. Attack from the rear. And neutralize.
Prepare to attack.
You're gonna get us all killed.
They're my orders.
I don't care.
Axios!
You ignored orders.
It's just another casualty, sir.
Unacceptable.
This academy represents honor, valor, allegiance. I am...
Halo, bro.
Worthy.
Miss you, buddy.
Miss you, too.
You are anything but...
Combat score sucked because of you.
Many, when they first arrive, hate this place.
Let's go!
You want people to change? Then you're gonna need people to follow you.
There's a soldier inside of you, Thomas. I can see it. You need to see it.
Well, what does this mean? You're leaving?
Attack.
What the hell are those things?
Go!
Best chance for survival.
It's a whole new war.
You okay?
Go.
Chief! Drive!
Mayday, mayday. Forward unto dawn. Immediate evac,
117. Play it again, please.
Thanks. That was incredibly fun to make. Driving around in a warthog in the forest that night is quite an experience. And seeing real life Halo stuff in the flesh is quite an experience too. We got the first two episodes I actually have in my pocket. You can't watch them, but I have them. But speaking of real life things from the Halo universe, I think we have a special guest today, don't we? So why don't we bring that gentleman in? Thank you very much, sir. So that's Master Chief, obviously. I feel like I should salute or something, but I'm not quite sure. This is the Halo Special Edition console, the limited edition console. We're really excited about this. I believe it's viewable down on the show floor, right? Or yeah? So you can get a look at it. It's one of those things, you have to see it in the flesh. It's translucent gray plastic, and it never photographs properly. You actually have to see it in your house, and that's a hint that you should see it in your house. And it comes with the game, and it comes with two controllers, which is actually really cool. And it's just one of the many, many things that we have lined up for the launch of the game. But ultimately, everything is about the game. All of this stuff is awesome, and it helps sort of build the universe and build the excitement, the sheer joy of making an amazing game that we love. And again, I'm really grateful to you guys for coming out and joining us today. And I think we still have a little bit of time for a Q&A. So if anybody in the audience has any questions, I'm going to be happy to answer anything except, will there be a beta? And we're not going to... Someone was going to ask that, so don't use up a question on that.
Yeah, if you look around, there should be... volunteers with microphones, hopefully. So if you have a question, put your hand up. Right. Bex?
Do we have mics?
Volunteers with microphones, anyone? Okay, let's go. This chap in the front row, just chat out your question. And, yeah. We'll sort
you
out
then. Can you confirm whether or not the faces will actually be good?
Can you confirm whether or not the faces will actually be good in Halo 4?
Honestly, I think that our facial animation and full motion capture technology is really good this time. We did, more importantly than just the sort of fidelity of the faces, which is, I think, excellent, is the fact that this time everyone who was acting in scenes in full motion capture gear was acting together in the same scenes. So that what that does for our cinematics, which are mostly in-game cinematics, all the campaign cinematics use the game engine, but run obviously a higher fidelity. But it really captures real performances, and that's important this time around because we have a lot of people in the game this time around, a lot of real faces and a lot of real characters, and more importantly, a lot of really meaningful things are going to happen in this game that require that level of intensity between the actors. So I think they're good. Ultimately, that's your guys' decision to make, and your opinions are obviously more important than mine because I'm biased. We have a question in the back.
Uh-huh. And we have mics now.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, at the end of Halo 3, the Covenant was pretty much in tatters.
Yes.
And the elites were, well, I wouldn't say properly allied with the UNSC, but you know they were on the same side. Does the game actually explain why the Covenant are back and why the elites are our enemies again?
Yeah, I'll give you a little sneak preview of it. You definitely saw the Covenant fighting the Prometheans there, and the Prometheans were basically objecting to their presence on Requiem, which is the world that this story takes place on. If you think about human society and human civilization, we're hardly monolithic. There's lots of different cultures, there's lots of different factions. You're going to find out about this particular faction, and they are a particularly virulent form of the former Covenant, with some really really enthusiastic, shall we say, religious beliefs about the Forerunners. And they never gave up hope. And you can only imagine their delight and surprise when they find out that at least some of their myths and some of their legends about the Forerunners turn out to be true. And that's something they discover on Requiem, initially in a surprising way. But the game will have a few twists and turns, and you'll definitely find out more about that, both in the campaign and in Spartan Ops. That's actually a big part of the Spartan Ops story. Thank you. Guy with the white t-shirt over here.
Hello.
He was asking what it's like to bring the Spartans back and recreate Master Chief's armor in better definition. I mean, obviously the armor has changed, and there's a couple of canonical reasons for that, but they are actually small compared to the simple fact that we changed the technology. We made some improvements to the graphics rendering pipeline so that we could have more polygons and animation happening on the screen. And the rest of it is artistic design. We have a lot of amazingly talented artists, And they worked very hard on the Master Chief, of course, who's pivotal there, but also the Spartan IVs, and you guys are starting to see some of the Spartan IV armor permutations. And another one in the back.
Question actually at the back there, Frank, sorry.
How do you go about adding new elements such as vehicles and weapons to the world while still making it feel like Halo?
You know, that is both the toughest challenge and the most exciting challenge. Halo is a sandbox game, and obviously Bungie created an amazing suite of weapons and vehicles and powers and abilities. And we brought most of those back, obviously, as you'll see. But the biggest decision that we had to make was to add a new villain and a new antagonist in the form of the Prometheans. And that's the first time an entire class of bad guys has been added to the game since 2001 when it first launched. And with them comes a giant selection of new sandbox items. Now, it's easy to come up with ideas, and it's easy to create these things, and it's more difficult to render them, it's more difficult to animate them, but the hardest part of all is balancing them. And I just want to reiterate that the sandbox balance in the game takes Halo's balanced feel very, very seriously. And while the Promethean weapons have some fairly unique attributes, they definitely fit cleanly and neatly into the Halo sandbox. And I think when you guys are picking your loadouts for your Spartans, you're going to, for the first couple of months, have fun experimenting with the various options at your disposal and the similarities and differences between the old and the new. We have one in the middle.
Hi there. Will Master Chief have a jetpack in this game?
I can confirm that there will be jetpacks in multiplayer. I'll tell you that now. It has been nerfed a little bit since Reach, and it doesn't behave in exactly the same way. You can't, for example, hover at the apex of your jump and rain grenades and sadness on the civilians below. But the jetpack is still in the game, and I'm not going to talk about campaign because we already got close to spoiling a bunch of stuff for you there. So.
Is there ranked multiplayer matchmaking in terms of like Halo 2 and Halo 3 where it's 1 to 50? So is the networking going to be peer-to-peer or are you going to have dedicated servers?
That's two questions, so you can pick one. No, I'll answer them both. The networking is peer-to-peer. It's obviously an Xbox Live staple, and there's some really good reasons for it. I realize that PC gamers like having dedicated servers, and there's some other games that have deddies. Peer-to-peer gives us a sort of broader reach into the existing ecosystem. We've made some tuning to the network performance, and hopefully you guys will like the improvements, but it's definitely peer-to-peer. And your other question was ranking system. We'll have more to talk about skill-based ranking later. There is an experience system that's connected to both Spartan Ops and the competitive multiplayer. But we'll talk more about options that are available to people who are obsessed with their skill ranking later on and closer to launch. And
hello.
Can you confirm that you've got four-player co-op campaign, and who will the other three players play as?
Yeah, I can confirm we have four-player co-op campaign, and of course Spartan Ops supports up to four players, and I would add it also supports matchmaking, so that if you're behind in the series, as it were, you can find people to play through it with you, and that's pretty much the ideal experience, because then you can play it on higher difficulty levels. And the first part of your question was, who are you going to meet? That's it. So when we did Halo 3, you had the Master Chief and three elites, and they had kind of a backstory, but it didn't have any severe impact on the game, other than the Arbiters, obviously. And the decision was made very, very early that creates too many problems for a story that's supposed to be about the Master Chief this time. So the reality is that everyone is the Master Chief, and so your big brother doesn't win that argument every time. And one of the funny things that happens in the game is you see the cryo chamber with all the cryopods, and of course your big brother gets to start in the center one and talk to Cortana, and the other three guys have to stand in theirs at the side watching from the cheap seats, as it were. Yep.
Obviously, Bungie were quite big on multiplayer. I was just wondering, internally, in 343, A, was there any like nervousness that you felt living up to kind of that kind of legacy? And B, internally, what kind of time split would you say you spend between something like the campaign and multiplayer?
So there wasn't any nervousness at all. It was more like naked terror. Bungie created such an amazing set of games and experiences and features that stepping into those shoes was genuinely scary. But there was pressure from the fans as well. Like, we're a new studio, we haven't shipped a full game. Will we respect Halo's legacy? Will we be able to do a good job? And we won't know that until November 6th, honestly. I'll try and get down on the floor and ask you guys what you think. Be nice, I'm very, very fragile. But we won't know until November 6th. And so we were scared. The one thing that we did get out of that experience was that they had built this universe that people loved. And they built a lot of systems and a lot of feel and a lot of gameplay that we were able to use and expand upon. So we didn't have to solve the problem that a new franchise might have. I mean, you guys know, like, amazing looking shooters come out every year, and some of them do really well and some of them don't, because there's some basic principles that they maybe didn't get right or people didn't like. We don't have to worry about some of the core of that. What we have to worry about is respecting what makes Halo great and making sure that we're doing service and honor to that legacy and building on it in intelligent ways. So no nervousness, just terror. And what was the other part of your question was? Oh, Halo's a sandbox game, so internally we actually kind of split even more towards 50-50, a holistic experience, because we have Spartan Ops too. So we kind of treat it as a universe, and it's hard to sort of parcel out which assets go where, and you can't really pull it out like that. Obviously, we have dedicated multiplayer designers, but remember, engineers are working on all of these things, artists are working on all of these pieces, and so it's hard to parcel it out. But you know, obviously, multiplayer becomes more and more important as the game goes on. But campaign is a huge part of Halo, so we can't ever let that go.
We've got time for one more question.
One more question. Make it good.
Hello, Riam. I'm just going to quickly ask a question. Just want to say, I saw the Prometheans, and they are absolutely scary. So I just want to say, brilliant job on that. It's about recon armor, I'm going to ask. Will that be unlockable?
If you send me an email, I will unlock recon armor for you in Halo 3.
Okay.
All right. All right. Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks to the Microsoft crew for setting this up, and thanks to the backstage guys for making everything run smoothly. And I encourage you all to go downstairs, check out the game, play it. If you see me, feel free to tell me literally what you think about it. We really want to know. And the code you're playing downstairs is pretty close to finished. It's about a month old, so it's a much newer experience than other people have played, and I encourage you to enjoy it. Thank you.